Hello, everyone. This is Kate Willens, broadcasting to you in Northern California on National Radio Day, which is today, February 13th, as my guest has told me this morning. And my guest is Sylvain Henry of Quebec, Canada. Sylvain, welcome to the show.
Hi, Kate. Thanks for having me.
You're very welcome. Thanks so much for being here. I wanted to give a little background from what I know on your work. Sylvain, if only we could clone him and put one of him kind of in each state and in each province in Canada, he has been really a Renaissance activist. And by that, I mean that he has addressed himself to the most important environmental issues of the day in the areas of clean food, clean water, clean air, and most recently, fighting against the TPP. So Sylvain is very up on what is going on. He has been a community organizer. He has tried most sincerely to bring people together when factions can develop in this movement and in any movement seeking the good. His background is he was a biochemist from McGill University. He currently works in content marketing and in online research for various companies. He's a community organizer, a chat walker, which I'm going to ask him what that is. He's an event manager. He's been an activist since 1984. And his main activist group is the Chemtrail Hyper Network. And we're going to hear about that. His great achievement, really, where he scored a victory, was in preventing fluoridation in his town of Gatineau, Canada. And he also provided an economic boost to small business there in the province of Quebec in 1984. He's most active now on Twitter, and we'll give you his Twitter address later on in the show. So again, welcome, Sylvain, and we're very anxious to hear about your work. So why don't we start with, if you could give us a little bit about the lay of the land up in Canada and how geoengineering activism is going there. And how the program is going there, I can tell you from here in Northern California, the activism that we do is not being heard by the powers that be. And we have been sprayed just relentlessly over the past few days and weeks. So how's it go? What's the sky look like up there?
Well, it was very blue this morning. Now it's kind of like a very cloudy white. We can't see any blue at all. I don't see any trace of chemtrails today, but it's extremely cold.
I would imagine. But just generally speaking, is Eastern Canada being sprayed a lot, or is it come and go? How does it go up there?
Okay. Typically, it's every day, most every day, and sometimes more frequent at certain times of the day, and which I find that odd because plane fly all the time, and yet you only see chemtrails at certain specific times and in certain specific directions. So, but in terms of the picture of Canada, Canada is doing okay in terms of activism against geoengineering, current geoengineering and chemtrails. A lot of the, I would say much of the main activity is happening out west in Vancouver and the western provinces of Canada. Some notable politicians, former politicians, are also involved, like the former premier of British Columbia, Bill Van Der Zandt. He's very, very active in Canada at the municipal level against geoengineering and chemtrails. And in Ontario, a few victories have been won in Ontario, namely Española in Ontario, and nobody ever talks about that because they actually had a lawsuit against chemtrails many, many years ago, two decades ago, and now it's all quiet now. And I'm trying to find somebody to talk about it, but they won't. Apart from that, the Bye Bye Blue Sky people and a lot of people I would say, southern Ontario, mainly women majority groups that are collecting money to put billboards on the highways and so on to stop the chemtrail activity. So there is some activity. In eastern Canada, it's a bit more quiet, pockets here and there. And I'm doing my little bit here in Ottawa.
So can you tell me a little bit more about this work with the, I guess you call them the ex-premier of Canada, who's working in the western side? What is going on? You said municipally. What is he doing? What's going on there?
Good question. The question he's tackling with is the municipal jurisdiction. In my chemtrail group, I have two police officers. I don't know if they're still active because I have thousands of members. But I met with two of them, one from Gatineau, one from the Ottawa Police Department.
Mm-hmm.
And I've seen their identification, their badges. I know they're real cops. And in the beginning, I thought I was going to have trouble, but actually they're on our side. So I asked the question, coming back to your question, I asked them, what can we do about this? And they responded, it's not in our jurisdiction. They said it's not a municipal issue. It's in the sky, and if a crime is being committed in the sky, that's more a federal issue. Because in Canada, aviation and airports and so on is all under the jurisdiction of the federal government. So coming back to what Bill Van Der Zandt is doing, he's talking to the mayors across Canada to wake them up about this issue and to see what they can do legally, because a crime is being committed above a jurisdiction, but the victims are in the jurisdiction.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So it's a legal, problem, but he's trying to address the question of jurisdiction, but he's convinced that it is happening.
So he was could you explain his former official position?
In Canada, the heads of every province are called premiers, and the head of our nation, you call him a president, and your nation, we call him a prime minister. So he is, so he was a premier of a province, of entire province.
Now, which province was that?
British Columbia.
So do you think that, you're one of the things I so appreciate about your work is you're kind of like an octopus. you send these tentacles out, to all these different avenues, and you do try to bring people together. And this is so much what we need. I'm wondering, given his background, do you think that we could leverage him into a larger role within our own movement? Have you been in touch with him?
Oh, yes. We talk on the phone quite often, and he is approachable. He's willing to meet with people. In California, as a matter of fact, I've facilitated discussions between him and Dane Wigington and some other people in the United States. Mm-hmm. But he's not the only former politician. In the United States, you do have a number of politicians, primarily former senators, who are definitely fighting chemtrails, like the one in Arizona. I forget her name, Karen something. She was on one of my previous radio shows, and she's doing a lot. And Kelly Ward was she doesn't believe in chemtrails. She's down in Arizona as well, too. But she did hold a town hall meeting about mm-hmm. the subject, which was good. She's the first one who did something like that, even though she didn't believe in it.
Mm-hmm.
So, yes, current politicians, no way they will help us because they're tied. Their hands are tied.
Except we've got some renegade politicians coming onto the scene here in our presidential election. And some of us are hoping that either Donald Trump or Bernie Sanders, being the kind of people that they are, kind of outside the system in a way, will be more available. I actually put something on Donald Trump's page the other night. I haven't heard back, but I think it's a very hopeful thing that these guys, one of these guys might get in. So
I'm happy you talked, you mentioned these two politicians because they have many things in common. And here in Canada, most of us believe that one of the two will be the president of the United States this year. But the other thing they have in common, okay, they care about the environment, number one. And number two, they're both against the TPP.
Mm-hmm.
And because if the TPP, which has been signed February 4th recently, is ratified or officially approved by the 12 nations, including United States and Canada. There is nothing we will be able to do to stop geoengineering, and they will do it overtly, not covertly. And we won't be able to stop them there. So that's why I'm involved in different causes, because, you know, you got to put all the pieces of the puzzle together to see the whole picture.
So wait a minute. Before we go into the TPP, which I definitely want to go into, can you explain why, given the fact that geoengineering presently is covert, unacknowledged, and denied, and they're already doing it, they don't give a you-know-what about anybody's opinion. We are bugs. So how really will the status be changed by the so-called ratification of this horrendous agreement?
Okay. Without going into the details of the TPP now, because you want to focus on geoengineering, I will say that essentially corporations will have a greater control. It's more about control rather than trade, this agreement, over our governments, okay? And they will be able to sue governments if, for instance, Monsanto wants to push GMO foods all across Canada or United States. Governments may try to stop them, but they will be sued if they lose in court. And if they're sued, of course, taxpayers have to pay the bill, which could be billions of dollars, which means weeks and weeks of work from each one of us. So the TPP agreement is a no-no. So these two politicians who are both sensitive to the environment and the TPP and want to get the focus of the American budget back on the homeland rather than in foreign wars, it gives Canadians a lot of hope that we will solve this geoengineering issue with one of these two.
Right, but if you don't mind, Sylvain, I still don't understand the status, and maybe we do need to go into the TPP to understand it better. But because geoengineering is totally denied, it's not happening. It's only, you know, anybody's conspiracy paranoia that sees these white lines in the sky, according to them. It's only water vapor, et cetera, et cetera. I just wonder, legally, since it's totally illegal, why the TPP would legalize it. And maybe what we need to do before you can answer that, because maybe we're both exploring that together, is tell us about the TPP, what it stipulates, and why it's so terrible. I mean, you've already spoken about the corporate control. That's very clear. But anything you may want to share about it would be very helpful to me and to our listeners.
Okay. coming back to your point about they are currently denying it, actually, to be legal about it, they're denying it in the public, in radio, TV, and all those things, and in responses to people's emails. But if you actually look at government websites, like the Canadian government and so on, look at the Royal Society and so on, they are saying, okay, they have laws in place to regulate. Why would they have laws for several years now in place to regulate something which does not exist? The Royal Society of the UK, back in 2009, said climate and geoengineering is the deliberate large-scale manipulation of the planetary environment to counteract anthropogenic climate change.
Seriously?
They're defining it. If you take a look at the Vatican, for instance, back in 1985, during the time of John Paul II, they minted a coin of the world, map of the world, with a plane dragging a chemtrail across the entire planet. Okay, and I could go on and on and on. So in public, they deny it. And as a matter of fact, if you watch TV news of a politician talking from the lawn of the White House or whatever, in any public situation, if you look in the background, there are no chemtrails.
It's very curious.
When a politician speaks in public, there are no chemtrails behind them ever, period. Okay? So they're very aware of that is happening. Now, I also, back on the question of being covert or not, I've looked at the Canadian website, government website, and they have laws in place about this, weather modification across the nation. They even have transnational, that means agreements between nations. We have transnational agreements on weather modification with the United States back since the time of Nixon, back in 1975 and so on. And so the laws are in place. The liabilities, they protect themselves. They say they can actually do this. And if there are any victims, these are things you can verify. If you look at the legal papers, they're saying it's happening and they're saying they want to control it. And if you look at the mainstream newspapers recently, they're saying that it's probably a good time for a bad idea, and we won't have any choice. We'll have to geoengineer the planet because of all this CO2 buildup. And CO2 is not a pollution gas. It is it's a natural phenomenon. But anyways, so legally, in the legal papers and documentation, they admit that they want to control it, and we don't have a choice. They have committees, the Solar Radiation Management Institute, and many, many other global governments. They've created a global problem, and so there's a global solution to fix this problem. And if you look at the Council on Foreign Relations, if you look at the United States Committee on Science and Technology, if you look at all the paperwork, the UK Parliament, I have this documented in a Google Doc that I'll give you the link to. People can verify themselves. They're saying they want to control it. They're saying how much it's going to cost to control it. So they're just being hypocritical to us right now when they send us an email saying, yeah, don't worry about it. It's not happening. They call it persistent contrails.
Okay. So in Canada, who is actually in control? Is this something that the government and or the military then contract with individual corporations to carry this out, or is this being done secretly through the military? Do you have any understanding about that?
One of our contacts in my group at Mass Action Demand got a response from then during Prime Minister Harper's reign, a response from the Minister of the Environment. She said in there that essentially it's some kind of experimentation ordered or organized by the United Nations, and it's all experimentation. And so the UN is involved in this, and they don't like to go into the details because either they say it's none of our business or national security. They have ways of, shutting up questions. If you bother to look in the Canadian, at least Canadian government website, there are laws about this, about, geoengineering, weather modification, and so on. And they have been in place for many, many years. This is nothing new. The same with the UK Parliament and the United Nations. And, of course, the IPCC in which is essentially part of the United Nations, they're talking about it. And there was a COP21 meeting in Paris a little while ago, and they've brought up the question of geoengineering at that meeting as well, too. And if you just go into Google News or Google search and you type in geoengineering, especially in Google News, you will find out that it is now in the mainstream media. And they're saying that we have to consider it now because we don't have a choice. Now they have to resort to extreme measures like the TPP because they see that we're very aware, we have knowledge, we have evidence, and we can fight this. Their main fear is that we'll get together and unite. We have not done that. But they're afraid that we will, and if we do, we can win in any cause, not just this one. But they have ways of disuniting us.
So I'm not clear, Sylvain, on the TPP and its relationship with any proposed geoengineering. And I don't know if it's too complex to unravel that legally. But do you have a sense or why is geoengineering going to be an issue in a trade deal?
Okay. The TPP stands for Trans-Pacific Partnership. It's an agreement made between 12 nations, of which your country and ours are member. And also 10 other nations which have coasts along the Pacific Ocean. That's why it's called Across Pacific.
Do you happen to know, by the way, the 12 countries? Would you, if you have a list, or I know we're probably thinking about Australia, New Zealand, you know, China, Japan, whatever, Taiwan. Do you happen to know? Are there any major players besides the U.S. and the states that are the countries that I've mentioned?
Yes. Let me think for a second here.
Well, I guess China is a very major player, I would say, and Japan, okay. Canada, Mexico.
My mind around it. Okay, I got them. For sure, okay. Vietnam, United States, Singapore, Peru, New Zealand, Mexico, Malaysia. And Malaysia, they almost chickened out of it. I'm sad they didn't. Japan, Chile, of course, my country, Brunei, and Australia. And so these are the 12 countries involved in the arrangement. And they've excluded other nations which happen to be in the Pacific also for specific reasons. They've excluded China.
China?
They did not invite them.
Wow.
Because this is directed against China. Okay. Hmm. Now they're going to make another agreement once this is ratified. They're not going to risk making the transatlantic partnership, which is called the TTIP. They're going to wait till this one is ratified before they go into the next one, because if this one is not ratified or approved officially by these 12 nations, they're not going to risk and spend a lot of money to go for the other one. So now let's just call it the transatlantic TTIP. It's nations around that have coasts along the Atlantic Ocean, but there again, they exclude Russia, India, and China, and there are specific reasons.
Are the BRICS nations, right?
These are the BRICS nations.
Yeah.
So they are preparing for a trade war and a currency war, and they want to exclude the people that are not. Okay, so this, coming back to your point about the relationship with geoengineering, this agreement is almost 6,000 pages long. It was only released a few weeks ago to the general public, though I was able to read some parts of it before it was officially released through WikiLeaks and so on. Now, it weighs 100 pounds. Okay, what does that mean? It means that even if they gave copies to the ministers, they wouldn't bring them home to read it. They are not able to lift it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so, and it's written in legalese, and it's corporate legalese. And so even if you're a professional lawyer, trade lawyer, commercial trade lawyer, or contract commercial trade, I calculated it would take you nonstop reading 5 months if you read about 3 minutes per page, and that's like a speed reader, okay?
Mm-hmm.
So in other words, what am I trying to say is that no minister, no senator, congressperson, no politician has read an agreement they are going to sign away. I've read parts of it, and parts of it I don't like. And you know, if you like the environment, you're not going to like this agreement. And they're going to be in charge of the environment, and they're going to stifle the government. Okay, there are very, very few chapters in there about trade, but the few chapters about trade in there are for major corporations, not for small businesses. Okay, they will suffer tremendously. Now, the remainder is control of trade, control of the government by trade. In other words, they're going to be changing the trade laws to give certain companies. Now, of course, United States is going to be the main beneficiary of the TPP, because that's why they call it Obama trade, because most big corporations happen to be in the United States or controlled by Americans. So they're going to have the best deal of all. I think the second beneficiary would be Vietnam. So Vietnam and United States will get the best part of it, not the citizens. There will be 500,000 fewer jobs the first year. On the first 2 years, I heard, but it's going to be worse than that. But in other words, they don't care about climate in there, and they're going to be calling the shots. They're going to be telling government what to care about regarding our climate. So whatever was agreed upon at COP21 in France makes no difference. And nobody knows what they agreed to anyways, except that they did spend money. Canada spent $2.65 billion there. And we don't know for what.
So, it is very odd. Very odd. You know, it's hard for me to see what could possibly, other than money, be the motivation for this deal. What does the United States stand to gain specifically? I've heard that, you know, a lot of politicians are actually against it. I even heard Hillary Clinton, who had been for it, is now against it on the campaign trail, at least. And I would imagine that the front runners are also against it. I can't see that it would do anything but tie the hands of the government and put the hands in the pockets of the corporations where they already are. Mm-hmm. But this would be open control by corporations, which I think is the definition of fascism. So, you know, do you have any insight into why this deal has gotten as far as it's gotten? What's the carrot?
The carrot? I'll tell you what the carrot is. The carrot is not orange, it's green. There is in Japan, the main negotiator for the TPP agreement is now in jail, okay? Because he's received a significant bribe, okay?
Really?
To negotiate. It's in the news. People can go on Google News, news.google.com.
Yeah, yeah. Right. Who's got time for the news, right? But anyway, go ahead.
Anyways, the guy's in prison, and he's the main trade negotiator for Japan. And they went ahead and they signed it anyways. Somebody else signed it for him, not him. He wasn't available at the time. And so the carrot is green. And Hillary Clinton, I've checked in YouTube videos. Essentially, she is for it. And she changed her mind because she wants to beat Bernie Sanders. And now she's sinking right now in the polls.
Mm-hmm.
And if
but green
she says
for who? Green for who? Sounds like
individuals. They don't care. Politicians, they don't really care about us.
I know that. But I mean, it's still OK. Would you go into the TPP, leaving geoengineering aside for the time being?
Yeah.
And just tell us, what will it change for us?
That's the question. The TPP was not written by politicians. It was not written by governments. It was written by the major corporations of the world who want to have monopolies in whatever it is they do. Now, they intentionally made this agreement so thick that no politician would have time to read it or have time to explain it to anybody. So it is not being explained. In governments of the world, the 12 nations, they promised to have town hall meetings, discussions, to talk and debate about this. And in each of these 12 nations, the promise was not kept. They did not answer the questions of the people, except to say that they will be contributing, before the TPP is ratified, they will be contributing billions of dollars to particular industries. In Canada, it's car manufacturing industries, the agricultural sector. They will be giving them billions of dollars, and this was a promise by Stephen Harper when he was prime minister, to compensate for loss of business. Now, they weren't talking about small farmers who will be getting these compensations. I'm talking about the mega farms, the super farms. So, the thing is, it is available, the main outline of it, not the 6,000 pages, is available to the general public. I've read a detailed chapter of it, and what I read, there was nothing good in each page. Now, there's 6,000 pages, and on each page, you could have many clauses, okay? We're talking about a 12,000-page commandment, and it's all for the big business. They don't want us to see it. The same thing with the North American Free Trade Agreement. No American or Canadian is able to see the final document of that. There are specific reasons for that. We are not allowed to see an agreement which was made by our country many years ago. And they promised us that it would create jobs and help the economy, help businesses. It did not. It did not.
So, Sylvain, I recall in the olden days, there was, you know, a trade agreement, I think it was under Clinton, whereby trade opened up between Canada, the United States, and Mexico.
Yeah.
Okay. And what that actually meant, I don't know, but I don't think it was good. I think it had something to do with taxation, and forgive me that I just don't know my history here. What I'm wondering is if you could give us a, you know, the bottom line on any trade benefits or any benefits, like for, you know, in other words, is there going to be some kind of release of taxation between these countries? Are people going to be able to move more fluidly and do business in these countries than they would otherwise be without it? You know, will it be enhancing commerce in any way?
Okay. They're trying to eliminate 18,000 tariffs with this particular TPP agreement, okay? And when they made the NAFTA agreement, the North American Free Trade
Agreement. NAFTA, that's it. Yeah, okay.
Yeah. They said the same thing, that we'll eliminate tariffs. Okay, now, it eliminated tariffs. Yeah, so what? It removed jobs. It caused offshore outsourcing. It caused manufacturing companies to move out of our countries to China and other places in South America. And the problem is when you remove manufacturing jobs from a country, we lose the ability to do things, to make things on our own, and we're relying to the rest of the world. What does it do? It destroys the middle class, because in a manufacturer, you have supervisors, managers, directors, and so on. You have that infrastructure. When you don't have a manufacturer, that is gone. So that destroys the middle class, and the middle class in America is going away. Now, NAFTA agreement, I have a friend who is still alive. She's in hiding. Who under Brian Mulroney, our prime minister, who negotiated the free trade agreement, her name is Shelley Ann Clark. If you bother to do a YouTube video search, you can see that the Canadian Broadcasting Corporation has made several films on her, documentary biography films on her. She was, back in those days, they used to call administrative assistant secretaries. Back in the 80s. Okay, we don't use that title anymore. But she was the head secretary of all the 127 secretaries who were working on different parts of the free trade agreement back then under Brian Mulroney. Now, there's a reason why 127 were selected and not, well, first of all, it's a big document, but that's not the main reason. You don't want the individual secretaries to see the big picture. But she was the head secretary of these secretaries who would integrate the final document for signing by the 10 premiers of our 10 provinces here in Canada. The final version which she had was not the final version. Okay, the final version that was signed was not the final version, the final version. But essentially what the NAFTA agreement is, it's the... how do you say, the outline for the North American Union.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, as you know, there's a European Union, there's an African Union, and now we have the North America. We'll do away with the border between our two nations. And that document cannot be seen by any Canadian citizen forever. Only the outline. So this 6,000-page document, none of us will see entirely. We can only see the outline. But the devil's in the details, and they don't want us to know the detail. And I don't know if you saw the movie The Skulls. Many, many great one-liners there. They say, if it's secret and elite, it can't be good.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, if they don't want to share it with the people at large, mm-hmm. and if it's only for the benefit of elite people, elite companies, then it is definitely something that is not good. They never explained back then why it was good for small businesses, and small businesses died as a result.
Mm-hmm. So. It's interesting that the borders actually haven't opened. I thought that was going to happen, but it didn't happen. But, you know, if you look at the overarching movement here, it's toward consolidation. and it's toward possibly, you know, a one world government eventually. When you said, I just want to go back to something that you said earlier in the show that I wasn't aware of, is that the UN possibly could be coordinating the geoengineering throughout the world. It's hard for me to see how that is, but it's just something that percolated in my mind, because I've been wondering how it is, just to go back for a moment to the geoengineering, how it is that this program is global. You know, that a friend of mine just returned from Mexico, and she said the skies were beautiful there. So I don't know whether it's just the more first world countries, if you will, that are saturating their skies with this so they can perform military operations. But I'm very interested to know how this is being coordinated. I did speak recently with Harry Rhodes from England, who, by the way, will be coming back on our show in 2 weeks with Scott Stevens and with Terry Lawton, to discuss this point. And I wonder if you have thoughts about the coordination of this program. Harry said that there was a giant computer system that he was aware of that I don't know if it's based in the UK, but I think he said it was, on which you could see atmospheric conditions globally. And, yes, you know, Scott Stevens, meteorologist, was saying that essentially, the chemtrail signatures were a way in which they could identify what conditions were in that particular area. I find that interesting, but I find that a limited explanation for the total saturation that I'm seeing here in Northern California. So, yeah. But in terms of who's controlling it, how it could, I mean, it's kind of like, you know, it's kind of like, again, I'm going to use that analogy. We're sitting as blind people before an elephant, and we feel the trunk, or we feel one of the legs, or we feel the tail, or we feel the flank, but we can't get a grasp of the whole thing because this elephant is hidden from us, except for it's not at all hidden as far as what we see in the sky. Mm-hmm. But how it operates is just, it's still a mystery.
Okay.
Do you have anything to say about that?
Yes, yes. Back to your first point about the United Nations.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. There's a company, an organization in Ottawa called the ETC Group. The ETC Group has been tracking the progress of geoengineering for like over a decade. Dr. Moody is the head of the ETC Group. Unfortunately, he never participated in my events at the university here about chemtrails and geoengineering, but he was invited every time. Now, they came up and they wrote some academic papers, peer-reviewed academic papers on the subject of geoengineering. And then eventually at some point they went public in the mainstream media, and they contacted the United Nations, and they asked the United Nations for a moratorium on the geoengineering, the current geoengineering plan in the world, and they mentioned specifically for 193 countries, not all countries, but 193.
Mm-hmm.
So they called for it, and then it died out, and they did whatever marketing they could, but they failed to get much public attention about this. Now, the United Nations also is connected to the IPCC group,
mm-hmm,
International Panel on Climate Change, and they have geoengineers involved in this panel. As you know, the United Nations has published a document, Agenda 21, which many people, many of your listeners may know about, regarding how the world should be, this global plan for the planet. And so, of course, geoengineering, controlling the weather of the, it's more than controlling the weather. It's military, it's health, it's different reasons.
Mm-hmm.
What was I going to say? COPs, okay, a part of Agenda 21 is the COPs 21 meeting that took place in France,
mm-hmm,
last December. Now, coming back to your global scheme, There is an organization called the Club of Rome. They invited me to be a member. Actually, I went in one of their...
Are you kidding?
And I went inside, and I could tell you stories about this, man.
Now, tell me stories. We want to hear about it. Tell us about the Club of Rome, seriously.
Well, they have the main chapter in Canada is here in Ottawa. It's on Somerset Street. And it looks like an old boys' private club, but when you go in, it's an old mansion, four floors. It's quite big, quite huge. And you walk in, and very impressive furniture, old style, you know, Gothic, with pictures of Queen Elizabeth everywhere.
Oh, my God.
Okay. Now, you walk in, and you have soldiers in uniform in there. I was kind of afraid to be there. But anyways, they brought me down to the basement, and they have cooks, and they have a huge kitchen. And they made a meal and for all of us, and we had a presentation. They wanted me to be a member. And I'll never forget the day, because I became friends with the ambassador of Japan there by just asking a question. I was unknown, and they didn't know me. They didn't know I was an activist, or I never would have been invited. I won't tell you the details, but it's a scary place. I might one day, but anyways, at the meeting, they were talking about, back then it was a global recession. And his name is His Excellency. He's not there anymore because they have three-year terms. The ambassador's name was Ishikawa. So His Excellency said, well, I will allow three questions. I raised my hand, and eventually he got to me. And my question was simple. I just wanted to put him on the spot. So I said, what are you doing? Well, there was the issue back then of, anyways, I'll just focus on this. I said, you know, there's a global recession, and Japan is doing its best to cope with it. And I said, the economic and employment engine of any nation are the small and medium-sized businesses. And he just took it from there, and I agree with you, blah, blah, blah. And then he asked me, what's your question? I said, name me one small business in Japan. He couldn't. But I just made my point afterwards is that those who are providing 70% of the jobs on the planet, who are buying computers and whatever they need for their businesses wholesale, retail prices, because they can't buy 10,000 like the government can. I'm wandering off here, but...
No, you're not. You're doing great. Keep going.
You know, anyways, I was escorted out, but...
You were escorted out? You mean because of something that you said?
Well, they just look at you when you understand you're not wanted at that point, you know?
Oh.
So, anyways, the Club of Rome, coming back to my main point, they have access to a computer. It has a name. I don't want to say the name of it. But they have access to a computer that looks at all the weather systems of the world, all the economic situations, and they examine different scenarios. If you have a drought here, how will that affect certain conditions here and there, and the employment here and neighboring countries? Will it cause war? And they can see the result of different scenarios using this supercomputer system. It's not a laptop. It's a...
Phew. It's amazing.
So
that's
they,
so amazing.
So anyways.
Do you think the Club of Rome, I mean, you know, part of the difficulty, Sylvain, is that we don't know who to address ourselves to in fighting this issue, because it's kind of like a Kafka-esque novel where you go down one beige hall after another and knock on doors and they say, oh, it's not our business. And the question is, whose business is it? Is it the Club of Rome? Is it the Bilderberg? Is it the UN? Are these agencies, you know, governmental agencies and NGOs, are they working together? I just want to say for a moment, Sylvain, it looks like we're going to be staying on a second hour here. And at some point in the next few minutes, some music's going to come on and we're going to take a station break. So be aware of that. In the second hour, I do want to get into you and your work and your background with all of the different issues that you've you've engaged yourself with, okay? So just saying that now. Back to the Club of Rome, do you think they are like the head honcho here, or do you think they're just some, you know, guys in suits that are kind of spinning their wheels? Do they have power?
Okay, that's a good question. Are they the evil ones? The Club of Rome created FEMA in the United States.
Are you serious?
A Federal Emergency Management Agency.
Wow.
FEMA controlled the crime scene investigation after 9/11. FEMA has camps throughout Canada and the United States. Nobody knows why. But they have barbed wires, and these are like permanent camps. They are staffed, but they have no clients in them. So it's kind of weird. So I don't know who's in charge of what, but I do know one thing. It boils down to corporations, major corporations. I mean, I think all our governments, I think most of them are puppets, and a lot of them are bribed. There's corruption. Corruption is rampant. There's even a corruption scale worldwide. And I think Canada is number 7 or number 17th. United States is,
it's got to be number one.
More corrupt than us. But anyways, a lot of politicians are in jail because some of them get caught. Montreal and Laval, here are two cities in Canada. Oh, my God, they did a major cleanup there. So the cops did a really good job. So corruption is being used by corporations, sometimes by the mafia as well, too. Like in the case of Laval or Montreal, one of those two, it was construction contracts. And so if you want power, you got to pay the price for it. And unless you're a billionaire like Bill Gates or a millionaire like Bernie Sanders, there's payback time at some point when people raise you to power. So,
you know, I just had this, if I could just share with you for a second, when you were talking, I had the image of a cancer, that we're really dealing with a cancer. And it's a cancer in the United States that unfortunately has grabbed hold of the brain and the heart, maybe not quite the heart, but the brain of this country.
Yes.
I feel like in Canada, you still have honest people in municipalities, in local government who are, you know, you can still, it's still kind of, you know, quaint and old fashioned in the way that it used to be here in this country 30 years ago. But something's grabbed hold of our judiciary, where our court system has been infected by this cancer. So it's really hard to hold anybody accountable if the court system is in bed with the executive branch, in bed with the corporations, in bed with the legislative branch. And that's why it's so exciting to have, whatever you think of Donald Trump, someone that's really outside of that and not beholden to that coming onto the scene. Now, he's a bit of a loose cannon, and a lot of people prefer Bernie because, you know, he's got a clearer head on his shoulders and is more for the people, but not even wanting to get into our election, but just this image of the cancer that has infected our country. And now, you know, and it's as almost if you take the analogy, you know, it's as if the residue of this cancer is infecting our skies. And we, our citizens, are trying to stop it. And we are somewhat powerless. I don't want to say that because I want, of course, we have to keep fighting. But I would like to ask, given the kind of dismal situation in which we find ourselves, how effectively you think we can go forward as activists and what we need to do to come together and make a mark?
I think we can win in the twinkling of an eye. And if you want, we can discuss it in part two. But I want to say something about the legal system.
Please.
A few decades ago, women were considered property and they were not allowed to vote. And this is a fact. A few decades ago, slavery was legal. And black people did not have souls, and they did not have rights. And there was segregation. There were washrooms for the blacks and drinking fountains for the blacks. and the bus, they had to sit in the back of the bus. And these were all legal practices. So our civil, there are evil laws as there are evil men. I used to be a corrections officer, and I can assure you that there are as many bankers and lawyers and even judges in prison. Some of them are so powerful they don't get caught. But there's no holy profession, and there still are some evil laws and that have to be changed. But now the TPP, this is a mega evil law in my books. And if anybody can prove the contrary, I'll be glad to sit down and ask them to point out which page there's something good for anybody in there. I haven't seen anything good in it so far.
Hey, it sounds like a real page turner, by the way.
What?
I said it sounds like a real page turner. I mean, can you imagine trying to read that thing? It would put me like to sleep so quickly.
Oh, imagine if that was a marriage contract. Would you sign it?
Wait, say that again?
Imagine if the TPP, that 6,000-page agreement, was a marriage contract, okay, and you wanted to marry the nicest guy in the world, would you sign it?
No, I would not. No way.
I mean, you know, even if it was that guy was Brad Pitt?
Even Brad Pitt, I wouldn't marry him. No.
But, no, I'm an activist for simple reason is that I believe it can be addressed very quickly. And I've done it twice, once at a municipal level, I had a success, and once at a provincial level.
I can't wait to hear about that. In fact, we may have a minute for you to tell us right now about, well, I hesitate to get in and then be cut off, but I do find it very interesting because it's kind of like David and Goliath. We're dealing with Goliath, and people like you are David, and here we go. You're going to throw that big stone, and it's going to kill that giant. So let's hear about it. Second out.
Okay.
Geoengineering is a grave mistake.
No rules. No rules. No taboo topics.
No taboo topics.
No fear of doom.
No fear of doom.
We are.
We are.
American Freedom Radio.
American Freedom Radio.
Skies look gummy, look crummy, look fake. I can't escape the dull heartache, knowing that my weather's been taken from me. Asking myself, how can it be? Bluer than blue, that's how the sky was. Whiter than white, those were the clouds sailing by.
Welcome back to the second hour on American Freedom Radio of the Blue Sky Report. And today we're interviewing Sylvain Henry from Quebec, Canada. And Sylvain, welcome back to the second hour.
Thank you again.
Yes. Well, we're very glad to have you here. It's been such a pleasure to speak with you. And where we left it off was you were David and you were throwing a stone and you thought it would be simple, not simple, but you thought it would be effective at this Goliath of the corporate oligarchy. Now, I would like to know from you what you think we can and should do in order to be most effective as a movement in going forward.
Okay. Our movement is one of many. I'm referring to, of course, the anti-geoengineering chemtrail movement, which is something real. If we have time at the end of the show, I'd be happy to answer questions if people have any doubts in their mind, or I can provide a link they can check themselves, or all official links to official documents. So our causes are real. We're not imagining things. We're not all sick. Some causes are won by people, and I watch these people who win causes. And like the animal activists, like in Canada, circuses are not, we're not allowed to have lions and tigers anymore jumping through flaming hoops and so on because of certain activists, what they did.
Mm-hmm.
So I look at the successful ones because we French people have a saying, nothing succeeds like success. So I look at the successes of others and I imitate it. And I've had, as a result, in my causes, two main successes, one back in 1984 and another with my son. He was 11 at the time, to prevent the fluoridation of our public drinking water supply. And both victories took less than 7 days to win, and both victories made the mainstream media. And so how did we win them? First thing, we have to find common ground. There's got to be a cause for which most people would be willing to stand for. Back in 1984, my common ground was the economic recession, which we are now entering again. And people laughed at me. I said I would do something about it. My real motivation, I could talk about it sometime. A friend of mine was threatening to commit suicide. I told him, give me 3 days, I'll see what I can do. Anyways, and he wanted to kill himself because he hadn't found work in 2 years. Mm. Many people are facing that right now. Mm-hmm. And so I found the common ground. Unemployment rate back in 1984 in the city of Montreal, which had like almost 3 million people, was close to 18%, which is bad, as you know. And people were jumping in front of the subway and jumping off the Jacques Cartier Bridge. And so there was a great desire to stop this recession. But at the government level, they were talking about separation and having bills to make everything French. And the signs of the stores had to be French, certain size and so on. So I was never an activist before. And to make a long story short, I tried many things that failed, but I tried many things that failed in only 2 days. And then I figured I got to be good at something. And I was good at timing. I knew when to do something. So November 15th, 1984 was the anniversary of our premier. Premier is like the governor of a state, but we call them provinces here. It was his anniversary of being the leader of his political party. I said, I'm going to give him a free referendum on that day. And I didn't know how to do it because there was no internet in those days. And I really didn't have a clue. I started by going in shopping centers and passing out pamphlets, and that didn't work. I wasn't a public speaker. And then I said, I'm going to go to church. I went to church, my church. I mean, the main cathedral of my religion. I was a devout Catholic back then. And the Archbishop of Montreal refused to see me. Okay, I remembered his name. Then I went off to the Protestant church. I went to a United church. They let me in. I was so surprised. And they said, what do you want? I said, I'd like to talk to you about a revolution I want to start. It'll only last a day, but I need your help. And he said, okay, come back this Sunday at the end of the service. We'll bring the board together. And then the board came, and I went that Sunday. I was very, very nervous because I'd never done this kind of thing before. Didn't know what to expect. And so they brought me in this very, very old-fashioned furniture, very rich, teak, mahogany, very beautiful. Crucifixes everywhere. And there were about a dozen people or so at the table. What do you want? I said, I want to give a message to the people so that we stop this recession. What is this message and what do you want us to do? I said, my message is only one sentence. Premier René Lévesque, help us to help ourselves create or find employment suitable to our education. This week, period.
Wait, can you just repeat? There was one word in there that I didn't get. Bring me.
I said, Premier René Lévesque,
the
head of our
government. Okay, yeah. Got it.
Help us to help ourselves create and find employment suitable to our education this week, period. Mm. And He said, well, what do you want us to do? I said, I want you to repeat my message from your pulpits across the province, everywhere, all your ministers. They said, when? I said, this Sunday. He said, then they said, can you leave the room for 10 minutes? We'll send somebody for you. So I waited and they came back. It's unanimous, we accept.
Oh my God.
I didn't know what to say. And the guy sitting at the head of the table gave me his card. He said, you may have some legal problems if you're successful. Here's my card. He was a judge on the Supreme Court. I never used that card, but I kept that card in my pocket for 2 years after that incident. It gave me such a feeling of power that I had a judge on the Supreme Court interested in what I was interested in.
Mm.
He said, your cause is just and right. You're not even part of our religion. It doesn't matter. Our duty is to help anybody who helps the nation in a nonpartisan way.
Wow.
And they asked me if I was a communist, a socialist, a liberal, conservative. I said, does it matter what I am? I said, all of us are committing suicide and having some great pains because of this. I said, no, it doesn't matter. And that's why we're supporting you. So I thought nothing of it. And then all of a sudden, newspaper reporters and journalists and radio station hosts, and I was in the media.
Mm.
And then a police car pulls up at one point, said, hey, I know you. You're that guy on TV who wants to stop the recession. I said, yeah.
Mm.
And he asked me, who are you doing it for? I said, are you doing it just for Quebec or for all of Canada? Who do you want us to address our message to, your message to? I said, we'll start off with Premier Lévesque, and if we can solve the problem inside the province, that's good enough. He said, I like your answer. He said, I'm the head of the police union. He said, we're going to support you.
Mm.
So that gave me more confidence. And then, for those interested, I have a copy. It's accessible online in Montreal Gazette Archives. November 21st, 1984. René Lévesque answers me, 2 pages.
Amazing. And what did he say?
Well, he said a lot of stuff, but the main message is this. He said, there's a revolution in progress in our province. It's a peaceful revolution, but a permanent one. Mm. It is my duty as premier of the province and leader of the Parti Québécois to agree with their message. And from now on, I will prioritize the economy and I will provide, I forget how many millions of dollars, to small and medium-sized businesses. And I will help citizens find jobs. And maybe some of you may remember or not, but we used to have in Canada something called employment and immigration. We used to have a department that would take care of people who had unemployment issues. We don't anymore. Now it's called Services Canada.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what that means exactly, but that was a victory.
Sylvain, you know what it reminds me of?
What?
It reminds me of, first of all, I have a huge smile on my face. I'm just feeling so happy hearing your story. And it reminds me of a fairy tale where there's a prince, you know, and he doesn't know his power. And he finally stands, you know, takes this great leap and succeeds. And it brings me also to thinking about the church. And this is something that I've been very wondering about, very confused about, because I am a person that believes in God and I attend a wonderful church. And the priest of my church knows about the chemtrails. I'm a part of the Orthodox world, and even we have a patriarch in Constantinople, in Istanbul, Patriarch Bartholomew, who is extremely concerned about the environment. And of course I need to write him. Of course I need to approach him. Haven't done it yet for various reasons, most of all disorganization and busyness. But I've been taking up the issue, or actually Marvin Herndon, the nuclear physicist, mutual friend of ours, this is an issue dear to his heart, and he wrote a new lyrics for the Ave Maria by Franz Schubert, and I recorded it. And we are in the process of making a video, which he hopes to distribute throughout the Catholic churches, even to the Vatican, and perhaps into the Protestant churches and other churches as well, Orthodox, because how can it be that God-loving people who understand that the creation is something that we need to be stewards of and protect, how can it be anything but a quote-unquote S-I-N, a sin, you know, a missing of the mark, to turn away from the cause of protecting our environment from very real harm, such as is going on in the sky? So this issue of the church that was so brilliantly handled by you in what you just described, do you think that perhaps this is a way we should go now?
Well, it's one of the ways, and in my past, it gave me the biggest success in my life, even though it wasn't even my church, because it had good men in there for some reason. There were no women. The organization of that church was all male, but it had good people there. But generally speaking, there are good people within a church or within a religion, but the establishment is very much status quo. It follows the government. Give Caesar what is Caesar's. And even though Jesus was a rebel and, you know, he was an activist, mm-hmm. you know, he went inside that temple mm-hmm. in Jerusalem. What did he do? He flicked out his whip and he started whipping the bankers. You know, I mean, he's lucky. Well, he got killed for it. But no, we can't do that anymore. But
we can appeal to the churches. I think it's incumbent upon us to do so.
Yes, yes.
I think if people really realized what was going on, they would be against it. You know, they would join us. So how? Okay, including the church.
Yeah.
What? You know, and let's talk about the lay of the land as far as the various movements within our own movement against geoengineering, the disunity, the dispersion, and how do we organize all of these folks to come together? Is it necessary that we do in order to fight this fight? You've got a very, I love the way that your mind works, and I love the way that you engage your will and that you're a doer. Where do we go from here? What do we do?
Well, let's talk about the pros and cons of the geoengineering movement. Now, I'll start with the pros. I'm a salesman, so. The people, there are many outstanding champions in the movement in different countries of the world. Harold Save, Max Bliss, Harry Rhodes, Michael Murphy, Dane Wigington. I've interviewed many of them, or most of them, about 30 that I know. There are a lot more, and you're one of them, too. So there are many champions in the movement, and what they have done is, number one, the pros, is they've created public awareness, which is good. It's step one. Number two, many of them have provided evidence that would be admissible in court. Number three, let me see, a good number three would be, yes, like myself and others have found pilots, commercial airline pilots willing to testify. And they're on our side. Okay. Number four, we have plenty of supporters. But I put supporters in quotation marks because most are passive, some are active, and some are not even real people.
Mm.
Okay, I can tell you so much about that. I've got a group with thousands of members, and some of them are not even real people.
I know.
But, okay, so they give you... Facebook, I think, was designed by the status quo, by the elite, for different reasons. First of all, it gives you the illusion that you have a powerful support group, whereas you don't really.
Mm-mm.
There might be just 100 people in my group of 12,000 who are very active.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not putting down the passive people because they're collecting evidence. But at some point, you got to kiss the girl, you know?
Mm-hmm.
It's enough to recite poetry. You have to do something. It's part of the pros to have a lot of supporters. And I like to convert there's nothing you can do with the ones who aren't real, but the passive into more active supporters.
Mm-hmm.
And I've tried that and I've had some success, but that's not my strength. But the cons are this. Number one, the fact that we're using Facebook and not a better battlefield like Twitter. And I could talk metrics here and stats.
Well, tell us about, well, let's go back to that point. I'm making notes here, so okay. I'll bring you back. Go on.
Go ahead.
Well, I was going to talk about the Twitter aspect, but I do want you to go on and let's come back to it.
Okay, sure.
Okay.
Now, the cons, we have lack of unity.
That's the big one.
That is the main cause of our stalemate. We are stuck. There's nothing we can do. Unfortunately, all the champions know this deep in their hearts. Some of the champions may not care. They're there to vent their opinions and their expertise. And I don't care if I make mistakes. If not, I'm not even recognized as an expert in the field in my cause. I just want to be the glue that sticks all these people together. And that was the original intention behind my Facebook group, which I called the Chemtrail Hyper Network, which was, and a hyper network is a network of networks. And I tried. I had my own radio show. More than 300 hours of interviewing experts just in this field alone. And it's all on YouTube. People can access it. But the lack of unity will make us fail most definitely. And all I'm asking for unity, okay, you could have your own groups. You could have your own expertise and people agree with you about this and that and your flavor of geoengineering. But the thing is, we have to agree to an action, a common action. Okay? I call it a concerted action. Nothing gets the attention of the status quo of our political leaders like focused, concerted action in any cause whatsoever.
Mm-hmm.
They will tremble with fear. They will kiss our feet. And I've experienced that myself twice in the past. So I'd like to experience it again, but on a global scale. So what could be the simple, okay, a concerted action. You know me, I'm positive. So I recommend an action, a strategy, which is simple, safe, sound, and even more than sound, which is surefire.
What would that be?
Well, I'll give you an example. That's something that worked on, partially worked. Several years ago, maybe 4 years ago, I started an email campaign to leaders of the world about geoengineering. And I created a template letter, which some people used and modified and sent as their own.
Mm-hmm.
But I told the people, if you agree to be part of this movement, this letter writing campaign, you must send your email on this date only and at this time only, Eastern Time.
Mm-hmm.
They agreed. I was amazed to see the number of people who participated. Because when you send out messages, you don't know if two people will do it. Actually, thousands of people did it because they thought it could work. Now, and I said, another requirement is that in your email, talk about whatever it is you want. But don't dictate, don't say anything that's not real, or just ask questions and don't say anything negative. That will scare them even more. You attack them with love and kisses and hugs, okay? So the day happened, 9 o'clock came, it was on a Monday morning, and then here's the result. And I'll never forget it. Result number one. We had 14 letters, official letters from heads of states and different government ministries sent to us within 3 days.
Mm.
That's result number one. We have a copy of a letter written by President Obama himself about chemtrails. It's in our group.
What did he say?
Well, he says, don't worry, it's just persistent contrails. And if you want more information, go to epa.gov. And they have a special page devoted to people like you.
So, nutcases, right?
That's right. So, but the thing is, we had responses from them. We got their attention.
Sylvain, do you mind if I just stop you a second?
Yeah.
Okay, there's a couple of things. First of all, there's the lack of unity, which I think we can overcome. Okay, I think that's not too difficult for us. I think particularly with you, with someone like you, with this hyperlink of geoengineering action that we could coordinate something like this. And by the way, I feel the same way that you do. I do not take sides. I'm respectful of everyone in this movement. And I only want to serve the movement, as do you. And I think that that is, that's the way to go. That's the way to be. There is no place for ego in this movement, number one. But number two, and this is the but, as wonderfully as the tactics that you describe work in a normal functioning world, remember, we're talking about cancer. We're talking about a diseased organism that will not admit openly the reality of this program. And so, you know, I don't know, because we don't know exactly who the enemy is, but I do feel that holding our elected officials accountable really is the only thing we can do. So now I'm back to feeling, hey, what you're suggesting, if we can coordinate it, or let's say when we coordinate it, is the only way to go. If we had, let's say, a letter writing campaign on a Monday where in every state in this union, every activist, you know, millions of us, or even hundreds of thousands of us, shot letters at our respective officials at the same time. I think it could be effective, but again, I feel like we're dealing with such pathology and such tyranny that we could be marginalized very easily by this group, this Club of Rome group, or the cabal, or whatever you want to call them. But still, it doesn't mean we shouldn't try. So I'm wondering, would you be willing to, first of all, give us your website, please? I want everybody that's listening to have your Twitter, your Hyper Network, and your website, anything that's pertinent to you being the person to coordinate this now. Could you please give us your information?
Sure.
Slowly.
Okay. CanadianSpartacus.com.
Let's spell that for people. Canadian. Spartacus. Canadian.
They should know how to spell Canadian, I hope.
Yeah, well, they know that.
Spartacus is SPARATAC.
No, you got it wrong.
Yes.
Spartacus. Yeah, SPARTACUS.
That's right.
Canadian Spartacus. Okay, that's your YouTube. Now give us your hyper.
It's my YouTube, and it's also my website.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. Okay.
So,
and can people contact you then from the website to actually? Okay, great.
Yeah.
Now, as far as the hyperlink and to join your Facebook group, how do people do, or what's it called?
It's a good question, because some people have imitated my mass action demand and created their own competitive group, which has nothing to do with me. So let me just give you the real link.
Okay.
Imitation is a compliment, even from your enemy. Okay. It's facebook.com/groups/chemtrailhypernetwork.
Really? So the mass action demand, isn't that also your group?
That's mine, yeah.
Is it the same thing, though, as this hyper network? Or is that a separate group?
No, it's the same thing. That's the link itself to bring you to mass action demand.
I see. Okay. So if you were then hypothetical, give us your Twitter while you're at it.
Oh, it's @@.
Mm-hmm.
9/11.
Mm-hmm.
Satyagraha. That's SATYA. Satya. Graha is GRAHA. And it means truth force.
Wow. That's in like some Hindi. Kind of a Hindi?
Yeah, Hindi. Yeah.
Yeah. I'm sure there's a story behind that one. I'd like to hear it. But right now, what do you think about the idea of you going ahead to try to coordinate us once again?
Oh, yeah. And I'm not going to tell people what to do. I'll just make a suggestion for action. And there can't be any egos in the way. All we have to do is a simple action that everybody agrees to do the same day, the same minute. And we will get government attention for whatever cause we want if we use the system.
Now, wait a minute. You know this... This May 7th, Matt Landman is coordinating a a big event in Vancouver. And I don't know that I'm attending that yet, but are you planning to attend that? Would that be a venue where you could fly this idea?
We could do it on that day. We have to talk about timing of this event and see how many people would be willing to do it. And you don't have to do it with anybody's flag. You do it on your own. You don't say you're doing this because you're a member of this or a member of that. You do it because you're a member of the human race and you want to stop certain things.
Mm-hmm.
And if we can accomplish this, we can have this, you know, this unity of action, a very simple thing for simple, safe gesture, which is totally legal. We can accomplish anything. And now there's a lot of lack of common sense used by government officials. For instance, you take Obama and cancer. He's spending, a few billion dollars to find a cure for cancer. Why doesn't he? I'm a biochemist from McGill University. Why doesn't he spend that same amount of money to prevent cancer in the first place? Mm-hmm. There's a reason for that. If we prevented cancer, then future generations will love us. If we prevent crime, future generations will love us. If we prevent corruption and encourage integrity in government and public office, people will love us. So I'm more on the prevention side. But it all starts with one point, one seed, and that's united action.
Mm-hmm.
And do whatever, you know, you could be an animal lover. You know, protect animal rights, whatever it is, but do it all the same day and do it to certain politicians and see if we can get, we will have their attention. That is, there's no doubt about that. I've tested the system myself and it works and I will use it again. I don't know what else works. If you do, tell me.
Well, let's just think here, you know, since I've got you on the air, can you talk about a first step to how to coordinate, let's say, Dane Wigington, Michael Murphy, myself, Alexander May Hunter, Harry Rhodes, all these people, Patrick Roddy, all these people and their organizations. We've got organizations in California where we tried to come together on the state capitol on January 13th. We had coalitions that have then formed a kind of super coalition in California. But really, there's only one group within that that's active, and that's in the Sierra Nevadas. Organized by Lisa Thomas, who's a phenomenal organizer. And by the way, you should probably be in touch with her.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, I don't want you to necessarily think that you need to think on your feet here. I don't mean to put you on the spot. But is there a way, I mean, should we send a letter out to all these people and say, this is what we're thinking of doing? How do we get these people on board?
You make him listen to this radio show that you're doing on International World Radio Day. That's what you do.
Well, that's today.
That's today. If they listen to us, if they listen to this, you know, a recording of this program, they may agree that it's the only thing that we can do.
Mm-hmm.
All we have to do is simple. It's like most people remember what December 25th is for, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now we got to give the world another date to remember. And that's the date that people wake up and say, we're in charge here. Okay?
Yeah.
Sit down, take a break. We're in charge. We the people, not we the corporations.
So, Lane, have you ever thought about running for office?
No.
No.
Look, I'm just a simple activist. I already had a death threat, so I'd need bodyguards and I can't afford them.
Okay. So we're going to circulate this talk show on Facebook and Twitter. But we'll also be making a YouTube video, hopefully, of it. And we'll have to circulate that, too. Of course, as you know, on Facebook, you circulate something and it will make some waves. And then the waves will eventually very quickly peter out. So you mentioned Twitter. And I want to go back to that point now.
Yeah.
How can we? And I'm on Twitter, by the way, and I've started posting there more. And you and I should be Twitter friends, by the way. I don't think we are. But they don't call them friends, but you know what I mean, following each other. How do we use Twitter most effectively in this fight?
Okay. I'm happy you brought the question of Twitter. How to use it effectively. I was watching a video the other day while I was doing my rowing in my rowing machine. And it was called Cooled Hand Luke. It's an old movie, and with Paul Newman. And the prison warden... addresses Paul Newman, and he said, "What we have here is failure to communicate." Okay, and that's exactly what is happening right now in our movement. Our movement, and I'm getting back to Twitter. There's a reason why I'm saying all this stuff. Our greatest enemy is not the elite. It's not the politician puppets. It's each other. This, you know, we're competing with each other. It's like, you know, the Tower of Babel. We can't understand. We won't try to understand each other.
I agree.
So, Twitter. I've been a member of Twitter since, I think, 2008 or 2007, and I never used it until I watched Cool Hand Luke, because I have 5,000 friends in Facebook. I have over 20 groups, and some of them several of them I have over 1,000 members, and one of them I have 12,000 members, and nothing gets done. And I ask myself, what's the matter with Facebook? I mean, people are sharing stuff all the time. And then I came to realization, who's sharing stuff? Is it people who are with us? Or as long as we're sharing things, you know, people are quiet and they don't do anything. So I tried Twitter. Last week, I tried Twitter against the TPP on February the 4th, the day it was signed. Because you have Twitter, you don't have this in Facebook, but in Twitter you have it, in LinkedIn you have it, WordPress you have it, all the others except Facebook. You have stats to see how many people viewed your posts. And my fight was against the TPP. And I created a hashtag, anti-TPP coalition. The result? 354,000 people that I reached in 2 weeks. Wow. Myself only. Mm-hmm. The result? People are phoning me from the United States and saying, I'm with you, and what can we do to win? And then they told me about their different causes for Trump and Bernie and, you know, and should Clinton go to jail and all that kind of stuff. So now I don't have a failure to communicate in Twitter, but in Facebook. To me, Facebook Incorporated, the acronym stands for FBI. I think it's a way to control people, because whatever you tweet about inside Facebook cannot be searched by people outside of Facebook. Mm-hmm. And even within Facebook, only limited people see your posts. Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it's more like you're sitting around, you know, having coffee and just shooting the breeze. But with Twitter, because of the hashtag system, the momentum is ideological. So people search for something that they're interested in. And then is that how it works? And then your post may be in the pool there. And it's not. Here's the great thing about Twitter is that it eclipses the person. It's not about the person. It's about whatever the subject is. Whereas on Facebook, as you're right, it's kind of a popularity thing, you know? I mean, the bigger names will get more views, more shares. So I do feel, and I've been perceiving this for the past few months, and I just wondered, you know, hey, maybe this is my own ego that's kind of feeling a little unpopular or something, but it feels very ego-y, you know, it feels very sticky, like it's a popularity thing, and it shouldn't be about that at all.
That's right. What matters in Twitter is the idea. Mm-hmm. And you only have like 140 characters to put in an idea and see how popular it is. Mm-hmm. Fortunately, in the last 2 weeks, I had 10 ideas that I had 1,500 views per idea. Mm-hmm. And what I discovered from Twitter is that great ideas are eternal. They don't die. Mm-hmm. I could die tomorrow, and then this idea can go on in Twitter and even make kids and related ideas and reproduce itself into maybe the next generation of Twitterers, you know?
So how is it? Can you tell us? Because I've tweeted things. Let's say I was up in Portland this summer, and I tweeted this tweet called, it said something like, "Hey, Portland, get hip to your chemtrail skies." And I took a picture of horrible looking skies. Well, that tweet is still getting liked. Okay. Meanwhile, if I put something on Facebook, you know, it's gone by tomorrow. So I'm wondering, can a person search on Twitter then with the hashtag? I know this sounds really stupid, but all I do is post on them and look at my feed. So if I want to search out TPP, what do I do?
Yeah, you put in TPP or you put in hashtag TPP.
Okay. And then everything related to that comes up?
Yeah. And you could even do a search for TPP in your city, and you'll see all the people in your city who are against or for the TPP.
Now, does it have to have a hashtag, you know, hashtag TPP and then my city?
Yeah, it doesn't have to have a hashtag, but if you have a hashtag, it'll be more focused.
Okay, those hashtag things have been confusing for me, but we don't necessarily need to get into it. What actually the little hashtag does, as opposed to just putting in the plain old word.
Well, putting the hashtag puts emphasis on that word. It means that you're connecting, you're finding results of people who really give a damn about this.
Okay.
Now, the importance of the hashtag is that if you create a hashtag on any topic, like stop geoengineering, if the hashtag is used by enough people in one day, it becomes a trend. Then it becomes an official hashtag.
Wow.
Okay, what does it mean it becomes a trend? That means that from overnight, if you have like in one day 1,000 people tweeting the hashtag you created to stop geoengineering, and it becomes a Twitter trend, then you will have from 1,000 to 1 million overnight.
Wow.
Okay.
That's really cool. Mm-hmm.
That's powerful. And so Twitter, I really love Twitter for that reason. I'm not using Facebook as much. I'm just maintaining what I have. I'm not developing because it's a waste of time.
Mm-hmm.
But I want to mention one thing in case we forget. And we talked about pros and cons. There's also another category called dangers.
Mm-hmm.
Number one, we're losing champions. Some of the champions in the movement, because of our age, are getting too tired. Case in point is our friend in Belgium, who used to be Peter Vareske, who used to be the champion. He was the only mayor to ever fight geoengineering, as long as I know, publicly, and to make a public report to the police. And the guy was mayor in Belgium, so he... But he's getting old, and now he's too tired for this fight anymore.
Mm-hmm.
But he did so much for the movement, and he was the founder, I believe, of the Belfort Group in Belgium.
Yes, I know. That is such a wonderful group. When I was actually beginning to investigate this movement and figuring out where I wanted to put myself, I was looking very closely at Clifford Carnicom, but I was also looking at this Belfort Group and thinking that these were like the only, well, not the only two serious, not at all, but these were the two serious enterprises that really interested me. And
so
I opted to go with Clifford. Go ahead.
Many of the champions are over 70. Okay.
And well, Clifford himself he's just turned, I believe, 63, you know, and I'm doing my best to help him because I believe that his research is very important as far as the health effects. What is in these fibers. But go ahead. I didn't mean to cut you off.
No, I believe in Clifford. As a matter of fact, I had some dealings with him. He knows about that. And I've introduced him to some very significant people as well, too. And as a matter of fact, I've introduced him to a commercial airline pilot who's on our side. And I've done some other things. So many of the champions are getting old. Many of them don't have financial resources anymore to fight. Some are having health problems and some are dead. Okay, so like, for instance, Ted Gunderson from the former FBI chief for Los Angeles.
Mm-hmm.
He used to call chemtrails death dumps.
Mm-hmm.
So that's number one thing. So once the champions go, that's it.
Yeah, but you know what? There's so many champions still alive. And you know what? There's something about this enterprise. And let me just digress a minute. This week, an old and dear friend told me that he wished I was in therapy and to go to, which I already am, and to go to a psychiatrist because he thinks I'm paranoid, and that when I give him information about any of this and related subjects, he finds it laughable. I was also seeing a friend this week, a friend that is environmentally aware and that knows about geoengineering, but there's no fire in this person to fight it. And I realized I am strange because this burning fire that I feel in my chest around this subject is relentless. And it is for many of us, you know, we cannot let that, we're kind of like, you know, a dog that continues to hold on to a tale or to something. We can't let it go. So I believe there is so much energy to be harvested. And if we knew that we could actually make a difference and take this forward, wow, that energy would light up in a great blaze. And I do believe that it takes someone that can organize us in order to coalesce our efforts and to make them really worthwhile. So I'm gonna nominate you, Sylvain, for that job, and I'll help you.
No, thanks. I appreciate it. If our generation fails, and how do you say the TPP may put an end to that, because the TPP will affect internet freedom and they'll be able to block us. But that's another one.
Yeah, we won't. Yeah, you know what? The TPP may not get. We may not succeed. There are so many people turning against it here. And thanks to your work in Canada, perhaps up there as well. Go ahead.
Okay, so I hope we will not lose our freedom to be able to fight. But back in the positive note.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I talked about the dangers, but here is a hope. If we fail, there's one group, one demographic group of people who have the time, the energy, the influence to win this quickly, and they are united already. Are the millennials. There are not enough millennials in the movement. I don't know if there's a millennial listening to this radio show right now, but if you care about this topic, you don't have any competition if you want to be a leader, because there's no millennial leader in this movement. And you guys, you're fearless. You have
there is one.
Advantage.
There's one that I can think of, Matt Landman, up in Canada. I believe a millennial is between what age and what age? Aren't they about like between 30 and 40 kind of thing?
No.
No?
No, we're baby boomers, but there's then the Generation X. They're like the teenagers, you know?
Okay, so you're talking about really young, like my daughter, 25.
Oh, yeah. Like I'm talking 16 to 25, that range.
Ah, okay.
They're not hot on this topic yet.
Mm-hmm.
You know why?
Mm-mm.
I'll tell you why. Because they always saw chemtrails. It's normal.
Mm-hmm. I do know there's one young man here, right where I live, that is hot on it. But you're right, there are very few. I find that my own children are just, they don't want me to talk about it. They're embarrassed. Because I've always felt, you know, I want to, as long as I could, I wanted to provide a normal world for my children to step into. And how can I let them know that it's not a normal world right now? But we want to bring it back, you know? And so because they want to be normal, of course, they don't want to hear about this. And I'm an embarrassment. It's sad.
It is. You know, somebody out there, I don't know if the Alcoa Aluminum Company of America is involved. I don't know. But anyways, regarding the aluminization of all the products we ingest, there's aluminum in our drinking water. They use it to clean our drinking water supply. In our medicines, they use it for vaccines and so on, in hygiene products, in many foods, especially pastry foods. There's aluminum. Aluminum everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
Why? We don't need metals. We're not 10 men, you know? There's a reason for that.
Well, and what do they want to do? Give us all Alzheimer's or something?
Well, I'm happy you brought that up. Do you know the rate of Alzheimer's has increased?
I do. Yes, I do.
It's incredible.
I know.
I mean, you even have presidents like Ronald Reagan had it. I mean, it's common. You know, it's dementia. It's losing your memory. It's losing your willpower.
So why are they putting aluminum into everything?
Oh, they have excuses. You know, I mean, you know.
So,
go ahead.
Well, the question of, again, and I keep coming back to this question, and if you know anybody that can help me figure it out, I want to interview them. The psychology of evil. If they know that all of these things are bad for us, if they know that vaccines are bad for babies, if they know that there are already many things that can cure cancer, but they won't let them come to the market, if they know that fluoride is terrible for you, if they know that mercury is terrible for you, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, then, of course, they must want to do evil and harm by putting these things out there. But the question is, Why? Why do they want to kill us? Why do they want to harm us? Why would they want to destroy innocent life? Why are they not truly pro-life, but pro-death? Why? This is my question.
Well, you come from a country who have a reputation of killing your own presidents. You don't need terrorists to do that. American will do the job. You live in a country that invades other countries, and in the Middle East has killed 2 million people, mostly civilians. We don't know for what reason exactly, no legitimate reason. Our country is part of that. We've bombed Libya. We've done our part in Syria, in Iraq. Hopefully with this new prime minister, things will change. And hopefully with your new president, things will change as well. Why is there such evil in the world? Between the year 1900 and 2000, 200 million people were killed in wars. World War I, War II, Korea, Vietnam, you name it. You know the list. It's on Wikipedia. You can find it. 200 million, mostly civilians. Now, the trend, World War I, it was like mostly soldiers that were killed or were killing each other. World War II, it was mostly civilians. And as we progress into the wars with time, the proportion right now is 90% civilians. So why do we kill women and children? Why does America and Canada have 2 million, a database of 2 million people who are potential terrorists, and some of them are under the age of 3? I don't know. I really don't know why there's such evil in the world, but there is. And it's up to us good people to unite, or else we're part of the problem too. Mm-hmm. Even if we spend 10 years fighting chemtrails, if we don't unite, we're part of the problem.
Okay, so Sylvain, I think this, you know, potentially could be an important show in that I know I'm willing. I don't have the organizational skills, nor do I have I don't even know how to begin to organize people, but you do. And so I really want you to consider that you may have, and not in an egoic way, but you may have a larger role to play here in terms of uniting us all. And I would love to be in dialogue with you or serve that in any way that I could. So, I just want you to be thinking about this and how you might affect this in the coming months.
Sure, I'm willing to help. If we can unite two champions, two groups, two people.
Mm-hmm.
If we can wake up the church, mm-hmm, and say, stop thinking about our souls for a second here. People are dying, you know?
Yeah.
You know, telling us about our sins. And so you don't remove the log from your own eye before you remove the whatever, you know?
Right.
I feel so worthless when I talk to a priest, man. I'm such an awful person. Oh, I spend the rest of my life, you know, making penance for my sins. Sheesh. So I can't afford to think of future sins. But, you know, we have to unite. If this show unites two people, great. Do I have a program? No, I don't have a program. I don't have an agenda. We have to unite for an action. And we have to communicate that we are united and we won't stand for this stuff. And we have to create a new December 25th, or we'll have to create a new April 1st.
What was April 1st?
Fool's Day.
Yeah.
You know, one or another. Either we're saviors,
you know,
or we're fools.
One other tool that we do have, and I haven't really used it, is the Thrive Network. You know, the work of, Gamble or Proctor or one of, you know, the guy, what's his name? Gamble, I think it is, and his wife.
Thrive. Yeah.
Yeah, they're trying to bring people together. I don't know how successful they've been, but I do applaud their efforts. And then we, of course, have to think about this May 7th date with Matt Landman, and I think he'd be a good person to contact.
Sure.
And I also really want to acknowledge the work of Marvin Herndon, who is a renegade and a zealot and not afraid to bring scientific facts into the public eye and risk his reputation to do so. And it's also been a real pleasure to record his lyrics for the cause. As I said, stay tuned for this video that we're going to be presenting to the church on Ave Maria. So I don't know. We covered all and everything. Let's see here. I'm looking at my list.
Go ahead. One quick point about Marvin.
Yeah.
Dr. Herndon is a PhD in nuclear physics, and he's the only peer-reviewed scientist that we have in our team.
It's true. So, very valuable.
Yeah.
Hey, our show is ending. We've got about 20 seconds. I just want to say, Sylvain, I'm so glad we had the opportunity to have you on the show at last, and it was worth it, worth the wait. God bless you, and I hope to work with you in the future. And please come back on. Okay.
Thank you for having me. Yeah.
All right.
Bye, Kate.
Bye.
See the truth and not hide. The future depends on what we do. Speak the truth. Blue.